Gregory Strakhartchyk, and I'm from Polytechnic University of Catalonia. And I would like to talk about, well, some algorithmic properties of diffusion Monte Carlo method. But and in this sense, I will not present, well, some explicit physical systems which we study. First of all, I would like to make a short overview of different subjects in which I used different types of Monte Carlo methods, and then this might be useful also for the afternoon discussion. So if some of you is interested in one of those things, okay, we can also discuss it. So I did some number of works using classical Monte Carlo method, just sampling thermal properties. That was like dusty plasma clusters, which were just clusters with U-cover interaction. Then there was a work on zigzag instability in a dipolar chain. So by changing the interaction strength, the system had a transition from a linear to zigzag chain. Then in a number of articles, I used essentially variation of Monte Carlo method with exactly known wave function. So in this sense, the results were completely exact. And this applies to one-dimensional Kolodziejczyk-Sutherland model, or maybe some of its generalizations. Then there are, well, just a few works where I was using path integral Monte Carlo method. So the last article was about studying the phase diagram of Rydberg atoms with 1/r^6 interaction in a three-dimensional system and seeing whether the system is gas, whether it's solid. Okay, although majority of, let's say, my works were done using a diffusion Monte Carlo method. And well, so more or less just the main subjects or the areas were weakly interacting modes, I guess, well, just in 3D, in 2D, and in presence of some disorder potential or speckle potential. And another area of research were dipolar gases, mostly in a two-dimensional system with orientation of dipoles perpendicular to the plane. In this way, there is no attractive interaction between dipoles and the system is stable. Okay, this would be probably a continuation of the diffusion Monte Carlo methods. Also, I have a number of articles on one-dimensional systems, which I like a lot. I find them fascinating. So there are calculations of so-called Leibniz model, which is model with delta interaction. And okay, maybe some its generalizations to, well, this is Tong-Girardot regime or super Tong-Girardot regime. And okay, the last area studied with diffusion Monte Carlo method was helium, liquid or liquid solid phase transitions, and the quest if there is a super solidity in such systems. And then, okay, there are also some articles where we do fixed node diffusion Monte Carlo algorithm for two component Fermi gases, which might be a BCS-BC crossover, or maybe particles interacting with Coulomb interaction and seeing where the system forms excitons and if those excitons can be described by bosonic mean field or bosonic terms. Okay, and even if the number of, let's say, publications where Monte Carlo methods are used is quite large, actually, at least in the groups where I worked and where I'm working, people were mostly interested in the physical results and not in the algorithm themselves. And this is a sort of a pity because there are some interesting things about methods which I never had a chance, well, or I never somehow published explicitly, and something which I would like to discuss because I think here is exactly the proper place to do so. And my talk would be essentially, well, three almost independent topics. So one would be a simple way to have a symmetric trial wave function for a solid phase. Then I will discuss if it's possible to have a DMC algorithm which would scale linearly with the number of particles in the system. And then I'll finally discuss, well, the topic of having pure estimators in diffusion Monte Carlo method. So maybe you can also ask just during the well, during each section equations, or maybe even during the talk itself. Okay, so the Fischer Monte Carlo method is very useful for studying properties of crystals, and a standard, probably the most widely used wave function is Knudsen of Jastrow function, which essentially has product of Jastrow two body terms and some one body term, which is usually a Gaussian, which somehow bounds each particle to its corresponding lattice site.
What are the degrees of freedom?
Degrees of, what do you mean by degrees of
freedom? What
are the parameters?
Electrons, atoms?
Yeah, okay, so here, okay, what is usually done is that it is either known what would be the crystal symmetry of a solid, if it is FCC, BCC, or HCP, or if not, this is somehow can be tested. And then for any given density, somehow we know what would be the position of the crystal lattice sites. And then somehow we try to localize particles close to that. Alpha would be just a variational parameter. And this is one body part. And the Jastrow part is the one which describes
you're solving for the electrons, yes.
Whatever, it can be just any solid. It can be either electrons, so like a Wigner crystal, it can be a short range interaction or dipole. So, and this term would correspond to essentially wave function in a gas or in liquid phase, which describes the correlations between the particles. Yeah. And this wave function is very good in the sense that in the limit of strong localization or limit of strong crystal, I think it describes very accurately the wave function and properties of the system, because each particle stays in a local minimum, and close to local minimum the external potential is quadratic, and then it means that the wave function is a Gaussian, and this is okay what is included in this wave function. And it is known that the energy calculated using this wave function is very good. And for example, one can find what would be a gas solid transition by calculating the energy for a solid wave function and gas wave function and comparing both of them, or making Maxwell Debye-Tallegrand construction. Somehow there are some disadvantages of this wave function. And one is that the symmetry is not the proper one, in the sense that here each particle is tied to corresponding lattice site. And the symmetry is not bosonic, in the sense that if I exchange two particles, I would expect that the wave function must be the same. And in this case, no, it will be just exponentially suppressed. So just, okay, this is not allowed. And this also means that even if one calculate the energy and maybe local properties, I don't know, like density profiles, it's not possible to ask very interesting questions. What are the long off-diagonal long-range properties, like if there is a Bose condensate in the system, or if there is a superfluidity in the system, because here the result is trivial. It's just by construction, there is just a Gaussian decay of the one-body density matrix. There is no condensate at all, and it cannot be, and the same with the superfluidity. A simple way to visualize it is just to consider a simple example of two particles in one-dimensional system. So I put one particle in position one, another minus one, and then the wave function looks like that, in the sense that particle one stays in position, okay, what is this? This is one, and particle two stays at position minus one, and that's it. This is the only possibility that I have for the particles, and I cannot exchange them, because there must be also possibility of having the inverse situation, but it's not the case. Okay, so the question is how to do a symmetrized wave function for a solid. And the simple idea one might think of would be to use the one-body term, which would be symmetric on the exchange of two particles. For example, a sum of Gaussians. Or another possibility, some people use just essentially any periodic function which has a proper symmetry of a crystal. And then the let's say the wave function looks like that. So now each particle can stay in, well, in any of the lattice sites. So in case of two particles, both one and minus one, one and minus one positions are possible. So now this wave function is symmetric under exchange of two particles, so it has proper bosonic symmetry, but also it has a sort of bad property in the sense that from the point of view of a wave function, it is quite normal that I put two particles at the same lattice site. For example, I put particle one at one and particle two and two, and this is perfectly fine. While from the physical point of view, this should lead to, well, to bad energy. So, well, if one introduces Jastrow terms, this sort of makes a line on the diagonal, which tries to remove those parts, but not completely, and also it still might have these double occupancies, which then will lead to quite bad variations in the energy. Somehow our goal would be to have symmetry which would have these points here and not those ones, so no double occupations. And the observation is that actually it's quite easy to make, just, well, sort of doing the summation in a slightly different way. So the way, okay, I just described now, we had a sum over all particles here, or the product of all particles, and then the one body term was a sum over different Gaussian sites. And then the proposal is to do the product of a lattice sites and do the sum over particles, okay, which might seem that it is the same, but in reality it's very different. And let's say if now I plot what would be the wave function for two particles, it looks like that. So I have two possibilities. One particle is one, the other is minus one, or other way around, minus one and one. So essentially this is the symmetry which I want. And yeah. So here the properties of this wave function are, okay, so it has a proper symmetry for bosonic system. So it is symmetric under exchange of two particles. And now it is possible to calculate the one body density matrix and superfluid density. Another observation is that this term is not one body, it's in reality it's n body term, in the sense that if just in the one body term I move one particle, I just need to recalculate only let's say n lattice terms. Instead, if I move one particle in the new wave function, I need to essentially recalculate n lattice times n terms, so all terms are.
Yeah, but I don't understand something. So basically you are throwing away states that I think they should be in the system.
I'm throwing away what?
Because when you remove these contributions from where you have two bosons, yeah, the two missing circles.
Yeah.
I mean, that should be for our bosonic system. You might have the some amplitude where the two bosons are in the same size.
It just depends on how strong the repulsion is.
What?
Depends on how strong the repulsion is.
Yeah, of course, but...
I think he wants to describe the physics of multi phases where you have strong correlations and...
I mean, I understand that you want to avoid the overlap where the wave function is close to zero, but it should be possible to have even a tiny...
No, not really. In the sense that I have a crystal, there is no stable configuration where two particles stay at the same site. It can be just, okay, particles can exchange. This is okay. And in my case, in this, okay, with my wave function, particles can exchange. That's permitted.
Yeah, and that's why you have
So, for example, if one particle is sitting on one side and the other on the other, in my case, it's possible that both of them can exchange.
No, that's fine, but
no, I think okay. Let's say energetically, this wave function is better, because the other one it has awful noise.
No, of course that I agree, but
okay. So from this point of view, okay, this wave function is better.
Yeah. There was this situation in the one form. Am I missing something?
Yeah, because
and you have also the product of one particle in the first side and particle two in the same side. It's also there.
If you don't skip some indices.
Yeah, well, but yeah, I think there are many contributions in this sum. One of them is of the order of one, and the others are very small. If I want to put, for example, two particles at the same side, then I'll have in one of the sum two good contributions, but there will be one sum which will be exponentially small. I don't know if this is very clear. But okay, this is mathematically how it turns out.
So I guess this is, you're talking about boson system.
Yes. Yeah, it's sort of avoiding permanent. Because here my complexity would be n squared.
So the analogy of the determinant, right, from Fermion wave functions in here would be just a constant. In other words, you would just rely on the Jastrow, which is not enough to break the symmetry. So suppose you make a very weak wave function that breaks the symmetry.
Yeah, okay.
And then you optimize the whole wave function, Jastrow, and the overlay to allow them to change. And you're saying that's never good enough for some strongly, more mod, like more crystalline insulating waves. You're saying you need to do this to have a good wave function.
But are you talking about this wave function or this?
So I'm talking about a boson case, right?
Yes, that a boson.
One would naively do would be what you described at the beginning. I would make a spatial,
Yeah, you mean like, yes, but with one body term or?
One body term, and then allow two body terms in there to try to localize this more. And then you can imagine optimizing the whole wave function, right? Suppose you, in that form, variationally, you make the parameters change all they want.
Yeah,
you're saying that number is good enough.
No, I say that actually people do use a function like that one. But I think it has much larger variance because I can put in a crystal, suppose I have a very strong crystal, and then I have situations like that from point of view of wave function, I can put two particles at the same side. But physically, this is very bad. And also, when I introduce Jastrow terms, this leads to very high, fluctuations in the energy. So, you know, what Jastrow does, it makes here a sort of diagonal, zero. But then here I can have still particles here and here, which is.
But you can also have particles between this. You can have a particle between a site, and then and one of the other particles then is completely unconstrained by the one body.
Okay.
You can have in your sum, you have particle one with site one and particle one with site two. So that would be big only where the orbitals, the Gaussians or whatever.
Yeah, because from the point of view, if I have one body term, the particles are completely uncorrelated. So I can put, for example, all n particles at the same site. And from the point of view of my wave function, this is as good as having.
I'm worried about the case that you don't have particle one in any site.
Okay.
So say you had two particles only.
Yes.
And in your way, so you only have two sides.
Yes.
So your particle two could be in between, in which case it could be the two site one, two site two. There, therefore, is no one body term at all for particle one.
Yeah, but I think, yeah. But
so you're just saying that's small.
Yeah, I said that, okay, at least in this, well.
I mean, if I had a weaker solid where there was lots of.
Okay. If I want a weak solid, then I just make this parameter small, and then okay, my just Gaussians open, and then overlap.
At that point, there's a big probability that a particle can be between two sides.
Yes, and I think that this will be reproduced.
In your wave function, then one of the particles is not.
No, why?
Associated
no, no, it's I, no, it's in sense that here, localization is strong as this parameter. So if my
Look at your do two particles.
Yeah.
Right. I have one with lattice site one plus one with lattice two.
Yeah.
With
so
lattice site one. And then I
yeah, so if now I open my Gaussian, if I make it weaker, essentially this thing will increase.
Right.
And then I will have some finite probability, finite probability here.
Yeah. And so the part where one particle is in both Gaussians, the other particle isn't in any Gaussian.
Okay, so if one particle stays in...
between them.
No, I would be able to get situational when I have particles in between. For example,
yes.
here it's okay. If I open my Gaussian, I will get it.
I'm just saying that if one particle shares, if you have in your term, you take particle one with lattice site one and particle one with lattice site two,
yeah.
Then there's no place for one of the particles. It has no Gaussian.
Yeah.
So it can be anywhere.
Yeah,
and
but
if that's not so, it has only constrained by the, it becomes a liquid particle in that part of the state. So if that's important, I mean that's bad. The wave function.
But okay, if it has no its own Gaussian, I think it would just give a contribution which is small. So my final wave function will be small. So this is not possible.
Well, yeah, I mean the physics eventually tells you it's just that there are such terms. Where a particle has no Gaussian.
Okay. Okay, so what I want to say is that the advantage of this type of wave function is that it's possible to calculate the one-body density matrix to see if there is a condensate in the system. And another advantage is that now I have, let's say, independent parameters, which are number of particles and number of lattice sites, which is interesting because I can have incommensurate geometries. I can have more lattice sites than particles, so I have vacancies. And actually, I don't know where is the vacancy, just somewhere. Or on the opposite, I can put more particles than lattice sites, so I have an interstitial and particle which has no place and it will hop through the system. Having well, a sort of double occupancies. Yeah. Okay, so an example where we tried to apply this wave function was liquid-solid transition in helium-4. And okay, this work was done in collaboration with Yaroslav Lutsishin, Dieter Bauer from Rostock University, Claudio Casorla, and Jordi Brunat from Barcelona. And okay, so here we have essentially two parameters. One would be the Gaussian strength, and the other parameter comes from the Jastrow term. And then here what I show is the variational energy as a function of two parameters. One would be the localization strength, and another would be some Jastrow, well, parameter in Jastrow term. And this, what happens at the density below the transition, and here there is a minimum which corresponds to zero localization. It means that my instead of having a Gaussian localization, I have just a constant. Essentially, I have a liquid, so my localization is zero. My particles are not localized. Okay, and this is the best energy which is obtained. Then in the density, essentially the transition point or in the coexistence regime, the situation I think is very nice. There are two minima, one corresponding to zero localization. So this is a liquid state. And then there is another minimum, which corresponds to finite localization, finite Gaussian, and okay, somehow different value of the Jastrow parameter. And it means that this wave function essentially is able to find two minimum, one corresponding to a liquid, another corresponding to a solid. And well, actually, when one of the minima is metastable, the other is stable. And this is very nice because I think it just describes the physics of the first order transition. So there are two minima, which are, well, stable or metastable, and then well, at certain point, just energy of one becomes the better than the other, but still the other minimum exists. So there are possible to have coexistence While, for example, in the systems where I had a second order phase transition, there was no any situation like that. So on one phase there was only one minimum, on the other phase there was again only one minimum.
Igor, I mean, in the coexistence regime,
yeah,
you have a continuous variation of the density from the solid. I mean, you have six or seven layers in which the density goes from the density of the crystal and the density of the liquid.
Okay.
And in that regime, the your parameters essentially go continuously from. I mean, you cannot describe this as with a single adjustor, no way.
No.
Because
the
density is changing continuously from one phase to the other.
Yeah, yeah.
So I don't understand what you're saying.
No, no. I say that I don't claim that I'm able to describe the just coexistence regime. I mean, the whole system of this. What I say that in this coexistence regime, this wave function can describe either solid, either liquid.
Yes, but only one of the two phases is stable. So what I mean, if you pick adjustor, the real system has nothing to do.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Okay, yeah. That's right. Yeah, that's right. So I agree that it's not possible to describe the properties of the system in this coexistence regime by using just one wave function. No.
Yes, but if you consider a stable system, the sense that you say either this is solid or liquid,
yeah,
then at that point the stable phase is the one with the lowest energy.
Yeah.
Period.
Yeah, which means that one of the minimums is metastable and the other is the true minimum.
Yes, but metastable in this case means nothing because there is no.
Okay, I would put in this way that. Okay, I have.
Up to a certain point, yes. Then, I mean, in the physical system, there is no. I mean, you have coexistence of phase. Coexistence is something.
Yeah.
How is the energy in the two minima? Is it similar? Is it the same?
No, okay, so just at a certain point they cross. So if I have the density which is small, if you wish, this, the gas, the liquid minima, has smallest energy, then I increase the density. At certain point, what happens is that the second minima goes down and has the same energy, and then if I increase further the density, just only the second minima has much smaller energy, and the first one eventually disappears.
Okay. If you do a calculation for an homogeneous system, with or without an ozonal factor, I mean, the old style, let's say.
Yeah.
What you find is that on one side you have a branch that goes up and you can minimize or optimize your function.
Yes.
It goes up to
the
field density if you want.
Yeah, yeah.
You have this parameter that will be the minimum. On the other side, you have a crystal that you can maintain. I mean, if you have an ozonal resists up to zero density, essentially. And essentially, you have these two curves, and what you're saying, okay, I'm seeing that these two curves together, but I mean they both correspond to some essentially homogeneous systems. That there is not, I mean, you have no information about the coexistence.
That's right. That's right. No, I perfectly agree.
The advantage of doing this with respect of doing the simulation for separately for the two.
Because the other one has no correct symmetry in the sense that, yes, you find that the energy is good, but there is no good motivation for that it should be the proper result for bosons.
If you want, okay, there will be a different way of describing it. I mean, there are wave functions that can describe all the system over all the range of places. So, if you want, go ahead.
I think it's somehow nice to have a wave function which is able to describe both liquid. Yeah, okay. And here I have a wave function which has complexity n squared and gives me both the gas phase and both the solid phase.
That's also complexity n squared. So.
Okay, yeah. But I think, okay. Okay, so then. Another thing which we did using this wave function was to check what would be the superfluid fraction or what would be condensate fraction in the system with respect to a possibility of having a supersolid helium. Talking about the experiments where it was found that the system was in a crystal state, while there was some superfluid fraction which was of order of several percent. So it was quite large. And essentially what we check here that in this case, let's say the condensate fraction that we find, and also the superfluid fraction that we find, okay, in finite system it is finite, but anyway, the value is by orders of magnitude is smaller. So here the one body density matrix and the asymptotic value is like 10 to the minus 3, while a few percent would be 10 to the minus 1. So in other words, okay, the this signal which was observed in experiments cannot be attributed to properties of a, let's say, well, not uniform, but okay, a perfect crystal, let's say, without having any defects.
What's the current state? I thought that it experimentally
I think it was not reproducible in the sense that different experiments had different, just different numbers. And then also, actually, I will show you a little bit on that. The result is very sensitive to presence of defects, which might be the surface or maybe just some inner defects. And there are also path integral Monte Carlo calculation where people try to calculate the superfluid fraction, say that it is somehow zero. And although there is, well, sort of mutual criticism that, let's say, one can say that by doing finite temperature calculation, if one doesn't know what would be the transition temperature, the temperature simply can be high enough. And if it is not known, what is the temperature? I mean, it's not really conclusive.
I think that also path integral ground state calculations of W. Galli and others essentially show that the fraction is zero.
So yeah, I think, yeah. That's right.
State, so
yeah, that's right.
With diffusion Monte Carlo, they used to get a finite condensate fraction.
Yes.
And then they, when they started using peaks, they found
zero. Yeah. So I think it's, at least it's not properties of a sort of uniform system. Another system where we apply this was system of dipoles in two-dimensional plane. And here again, I'm showing exactly a similar plot. This is density close to the phase transition point. And then if I'm using non-symmetrized wave function, it just goes to zero, I mean, in a very rapid way. If I do the symmetrized wave function, then I find some signal which is finite for finite number of particles, and then sort of reduced. And again, the numbers are very small. This is of order of 10 to the minus 3. And then here also we study what will happen if we add some defects to the crystal. So for example, here we consider what would be the condensate fraction, this superfluid fraction. This is a crystal with 90 lattice sites. And then if I put, and this is number of particles. When I put 90 particles, I have, in this sense, a crystal without defects. So everything is right. And my condensate fraction is extremely small. Okay, it can be whatever, 10 to the minus 3 or whatever, but definitely it's very small. And then by adding just, few defects, which would be, if I have smaller number of particles, I have vacancies in the system. And then this vacancy is a sort of quasi-particle because it, for vacancy, it is the same to stay in one lattice site and the other lattice site, so it can move. And essentially, this contributes both to the condensate fraction and to the superfluid fraction. So this red line corresponds to a gas phase. Okay, then to some extent there is no difference. And then if the number of vacancies is, I mean, if it's small or large, it's like 5%, then essentially the system has this condensate fraction the same as in the gas. And essentially the same as seen in the superfluid fraction. That having just a single impurity, this would correspond to having like 3% of impurities, actually gives a very large contribution to the superfluid fraction. So to some extent, this what might have happened in the experiments, in the sense that presence of defects changes just dramatically the superfluidity and condensate. Yeah, so with that, I conclude with the first part, which corresponds to proposing a symmetric wave function which has n squared complexity and allows to calculate the off-diagonal Lagrangian properties such as condensate and superfluid fraction, and it also can be applied for study of vacancies and interstitials. Yeah. Then I'd like to comment on possibility of having a code which might scale in a better way than n squared. And in a standard formulation, essentially, one has to to calculate the interaction between n squared particles, and this is essentially where the n squared term comes from. And okay, in principle, one can do a sort of truncation of the interaction. It's shorter distance, and then just consider only neighboring particles, and this, in principle, would solve the problem. But then this can be applied only if the potential energy is not Lagrange. But this is fine in the sense that in a number of systems, just even the hard sphere interaction is relevant. Another problem is that in addition we have two body Jastrow terms, which also, well, a sort of Lagrange, in sense that, for example, okay, like this article by Arietta Chesterov, 67, where they essentially demonstrated that if there is sound in the system, and this is typically the case, then the two-body Jastrow term for large distance between two particles essentially should behave like that. So in three-dimensional system, it's exponent minus something divided by r squared, and this is something depends on the speed of sound. In 2D, it's exponential decay. In 1D, it's even worse. It's sinus to some power. So there is really a strong correlations in the Jastrow term. And this is coming from just having phonons. So it's quite generic. And then actually what happens that if I do such type of truncation, both in the potential and in the Jastrow term. So for example, instead of having something which goes like that and goes to one at half size of the box, I do it before, then okay, then essentially I'm sort of leaving out Lagrange part in the Jastrow term. And then, but then on the other hand, my complexity would scale like n times the number of neighbor terms. Neighbor terms are essentially the volume which I have inside the cutoff radius. And then, in order to test, if this can be done, essentially I would like to take some system where I know a priori what is the answer and just test for this one. And well, actually I am fond of one-dimensional systems, so I consider the Lieblinger Hamiltonian, which corresponds to having kinetic energy and particles and delta repulsion with some strength. And okay, so in this this system can be solved exactly for the energy, and also depending on the parameter, it can go from weakly interacting Bose gas to strongly repulsive Bose gas, or what is called also a Stone-Girardot regime, where one can map the properties of the system onto the system of ideal fermions. Because the idea is that essentially when two fermions meet, there should be zero in the density because of the Pauli exclusion principle, while for bosons with delta interaction, which has infinite strength, it also vanishes, but due to potential energy. And apart from this potential energy, at zero, there is no interaction energy at finite distances. So this makes a very strong analogy between ideal Fermi gas and ideal Bose gas. And ideal Fermi gas in one-dimensional system has very amazing properties in the sense that the Slater determinant, which would be just filling plane waves from one to some number, essentially corresponds to here having some term, this term, to the power 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, and minus 1. So the Slater determinant has very special structure, what is known as Vandermonde matrix. And the magic is that this determinant can be explicitly evaluated. So instead of having n cube terms, one obtains just n square terms. Essentially, this this determinant can be written as a product of a sort of, well, essentially just of terms. Or I can write them as sinus of this thing. So in other words, instead of having fermionic complexity of n cube, this is just bosonic complexity of n squared. And then, okay, we will use this wave function. And essentially the difference between bosons and fermions is that for bosons, I need to take the modulus of the fermionic wave function. So, and then if I exchange two particles, I have the same, okay, the same sign. And okay, so this is what was argued by Marvin Girardot, essentially that the bosonic wave function is the modulus of the fermionic wave function. And then it means that the properties which depend only on the modulus of the wave function, like pair correlation function, some density profiles, they will be exactly the same for bosons and fermions. Yeah. Also, it turns out that the energy is exactly the same, while non-diagonal properties like one-body density matrix or momentum distribution can be quite different. For example, if I consider the momentum distribution for fermions, it's just a step function, and for bosons, okay, this is something quite different, but to some extent, this is something which can be anyway calculated. Okay, so for this Tong-Girardot, I guess, what I do is that I truncate the Jastrow wave function, and then I see if it's possible anyway to reproduce the correct properties of the system. And for example, my energy, my variational energy is spoiled in the sense that, okay, my wave function is quite bad, my energy is large, but then if I do a diffusion Monte Carlo method, it puts the energy on the proper place. So for the energy, okay, this works, but this is a sort of maybe the best quantity to calculate. So what about the correlation function? So for example, the static structure factor is something which should go linearly from zero to, well, essentially to K Fermi, and then this one. And then the question, what will happen to it if I describe in quite bad way the long range part of my physics, then this would mean that there is something bad would happen for small momenta. Yeah, and indeed, that's like that. In the sense that if I do just for the variational calculation, I get something which even doesn't go to zero. In this case, it was going to, well, some finite value. If I use a mixed estimator for the static structure factor, I get, well, something which tries to correct this effect. And then if I do extrapolation from variational to mixed to essentially pure, there are two ways of doing it. I almost recover, although, okay, maybe one method of extrapolation might be better than the other, but a priori it's not known which one is better. And if I do a pure estimator, then actually, well, it works. It just puts the correlation function to its place. So in this sense, it's still possible to do the proper calculation both for the energy and for correlation functions. And so from this point of view, it's good because we have a linear number of particles complexity of the algorithm. The bad point is that it definitely, well, doesn't describe well long range part of the Jastrow term or the phononic part. The good thing is that if you use pure estimators, this fixes both the energy and correlation function. But then there is still an open question. I think this is not in the end of the story, in the sense that the sort of real complexity of the algorithm changes with the number of particles, and this comes out from the time step. And this can be seen, for example, in this way, so that that in the algorithm we are solving the Schrödinger equation imaginary time, and they know that for large imaginary times we get a projection to the ground state wave function. And then, well, when we do important sampling, essentially what we do, we solve the corresponding equation for the product of the trial wave function times the true ground state wave function, and then the differential equation is essentially the diffusion, then there is a drift force and the local energy. And then in the algorithm we have, well, corresponding, well, essentially three terms. You say that the probability distribution of, well, of the f of this product of trial wave function times the ground state wave function is the probability distribution of population of walkers that are functions. Then we, in diffusion, we move it according to the Gaussian drift force. We move it in the direction where the trial wave function is larger. And then there is most important term, which is branching, which essentially corrects the variational energy, puts it to the diffusion energy. And this is essentially giving more weight to the points or to the walkers which have better local energy. And in order to algorithm be working, essentially what we need, that exponent of local energy minus, well, the shift energy or the essentially the ground state energy times time step should be small. And then it means that sort of the typical variance in my energy times the time step should be small. And then if I measure the, what would be the distribution on my, of my energy per particle, it can, it might look, well, like that. I'm changing number of particles, my average value just converges to some thermodynamic value, which would be, well, and also the width, actually it's what would be just the variance. It shrinks for a larger system size. And if I ask what is the dispersion, it in the energy per particle, it shrinks like typically 1/√ of number of particles. But this is, the problem is that this is energy per particle. Instead, here I have the total energy. So essentially, I need to multiply by a factor of n. And then it means that I have here something which scales like √n times time step, it should be smaller than 1. It means that my time step typically should be reduced when I increase the number of particles. And more or less this this law should be like 1/√ of number of particles. And then if, well, in this sense, the true complexity of the method is no longer, let's say, n² for bosons, but would be like n to, well, √2.5. And the, let's say this linear method would be n to 1.5, and then if I want fermions, n to 3.5. And this is sort of open question in the sense that I don't know how to fix it. So maybe later if you have some ideas.
I mean, if you have a long range, you do A-ball, that's in 3 halves, it's not n².
No, but this is problem not it's also a problem even for short range interaction. Because here what
I
was.
No, I understood you're 1.5 or whatever, but I'm just saying that the long range doesn't, never goes, for a periodic system, it never goes to n². It's long range, you use Ewald's, or something better, but at least Ewald, which is in 3/2.
Hmm. You could use Wolf or something like that.
Yeah, I mean, there's other things you can do.
Which is n².
Which is, you say it is? Or?
Wolf is linear. I mean,
yeah,
Wolf
okay.
Simulation.
Okay, let's put it in another way. I think that, for example, the path integral calculations, which could be path integral Monte Carlo or peaks, actually they don't have this problem of the, let's say, slowdown of the time step.
No, I wasn't arguing with your 0.5. I was just saying when you said
it's quadratic.
Squared 3.5 or whatever.
Yeah.
You know, you don't ever need the square.
Okay. Yeah.
You mean the complexity per move, or
I just mean to calculate the total pairwise potential of the system.
So typically, you consider at least all pairs in your box.
Why would you do that? If it's a long range, if it's Coulomb, no one does that.
You know, no, I say that because if we have just of term here. Which then means that I need to consider all the pairs.
No, you don't. Well, you need to consider all the pairs, but you don't have to do it in real space.
Okay, I mean, okay,
right,
maybe.
Calculated just the way people do Ewald. In Ewald, you don't consider all the pairs in the box because that's crazy.
Because what I say that if there is sound in a system, then definitely there is long range correlation between
so
Jastrow.
So you use Ewald for that part. And it's n to the 3/2 or better.
No, I mean here it's, well, people do, okay. Usually it's in coordinate space. Okay.
Yes, but no, but
okay.
Coulomb's a coordinate space. All I'm saying is you just do half of the Coulomb sum in momentum space. I mean, all classical.
Okay, that
all
is
classical
good.
DNA, molecular dynamics. They do millions of particles, and they have long range forces, and they don't have, n squared.
Okay. Yeah. Might be. It might be that. Yeah.
So that goes away.
Yeah, this, because here there is a limitation of, I don't know, maybe like 1,000 particles. So making much more or more, it's essentially not possible with this type of algorithm.
I mean, I agree with you.
Then maybe just making some, splitting some sums into coordinate space and momentum space might make it more efficient. Okay, so then I would like to move to the last part, which would be just considering pure estimators in diffusion Monte Carlo method. So the good points about diffusion Monte Carlo method is that it permits to calculate the energy in at least conceptually exact way. So in the sense that taking all appropriate limits, the energy should come out to be exact. And also local properties, like potential energy per distribution function and density profiles come out to be, or there is way to calculate them in a pure way. Still, the problem is that non-local properties like the one-body density matrix, momentum distribution, or condensate fraction cannot be calculated in a pure way. And what is usually is done to use extrapolation technique by taking variational results, mixed results, and then extrapolating them to more or less pure. But then the problem is that it's not really clear what is the accuracy of this extrapolation, and especially if one asks if the condensate fraction is zero or it is just some finite but small value. While this problem can be successfully well solved in some other methods, for example, path integral Monte Carlo or peaks, and sort of the question if it's possible to calculate the one-body density matrix in a pure way. And essentially, I was always told that it's not possible. And then there are conceptually two possibilities: that indeed there are there are no algorithm to do so, or I was asking wrong people. So actually, I would like to address auditory question: if it's possible to calculate one-body density matrix in a pure way. So what is your opinion, if you have any? In what?
Almost pure
way. Sebastiana, what do you think?
Pure.
Yeah. If you use you have to transform the observable, like the Ashraf and Kafarel type. So you can get a significantly more pure.
More pure, okay.
You go to momentum space, you compute the core.
Yeah, or just transform the delta function into the gradient and then apply the gradient onto your.
Okay. Okay. And then here at the conference, essentially, I asked David Sipperly, and he said, yeah, of course you can do it. We did it 40 years ago. I said, okay, but then probably it's then should be published. Yeah, maybe you should. Well, I don't remember, maybe you should ask Kevin Schmidt.
I have not done this in a pure way. So I can
because he was forwarding this question to you.
I have not done this. Pure means forward walking. Is that what pure means?
Yeah.
Yeah, but I don't see why it would be particularly difficult. But maybe I.
Yeah, so the answer is it's possible. Yeah, that's interesting. Depending on the person you ask, the answer is negative or positive. Yeah, and I think it's actually possible by doing this, essentially forward walking. And so when we calculate one-body density matrix, what we want to calculate is this integral where we have ground state wave function with one particle which is displaced, and this is not displaced. And then we want to have both of them in just in a ground state function. And then what we can do, just take the same expression and multiply it and divide by the trial wave function with displaced and not displaced particles. So essentially the, well, we get this thing, essentially. It's just.
I should say, I certainly tried that. I mean, what I found was that the variation was so bad that it wasn't useful in practice.
Okay.
But maybe that was just.
And well, in essentially analyzing what the terms mean, I have one term which is product of the trial wave function and the ground state wave function at R, and this essentially what is my DMC algorithm gives me. Essentially, if I average something, okay, this quantity about my on my path, I will get it. So essentially, this term is clear how to do. Okay, and then okay, and following I will call it F. I mean this product, so we'll make it maybe easier. Okay, then another term would be the ratio between trial wave function with displaced and not displaced particle. And this is sort of standard term which is calculated by calculation of one-body dense matrix. And since that if I do it in a variational way, simply know what trial wave function, I'll get the variational estimator. If I do it in a diffusion Monte Carlo method, I mean this average this thing, I'll get a mixed estimator. So the, let's say the crucial difference is the, okay, this third term, which is essentially the weight of the ground state wave function to the trial wave function with displaced coordinate. Yeah. And okay, indeed there is an article by 74 by Carlos Winchester, where it was shown that at least for non-displaced particle, if I just have instead of R1 plus R, I have just particle R1, then this ratio of the ground state wave function divided by the trial wave function at the point would correspond to the asymptotical number of sands of Walker which I had in this position. And sort of the problem is that there is I cannot use this thing because there is no Walker in displaced position, and this is where I want to calculate it. Okay, so if there is no such Walker, let's just create it. So the idea is to create a virtual worker how you can call it, and put it essentially in this displaced position, and then let it propagate in the imaginary time. And then asymptotically for large times, the number of sands it will have will exactly correspond to this ratio. And the worker is virtual in the sense that it should not contribute to the energy because it's not physical. We just put it there by hand. And talking with David Sipelich, he said that okay, maybe it's okay, can we also call the sidewalk in the sense that if you have walkers which diffuse in imaginary time, then what I take, I just displace some of the particles and create another walker, which I propagate. Then when it's propagated large enough, I just do the measurement, then I kill it, and that's it. And he called it sidewalking. Okay, so let's check if this works. And again, so I consider this situation where I spoil just hugely my wave function. It's like that. And then I check how the number of sands, so let's say the weight, changes with the propagation imaginary time step, in the sense that what I want to have the asymptotic number of sands. And then if I do it for example, for bosons, I can find some correction which then converges to some value. And here I do it for bosons and for fermions. And well, yeah, similarly, it's possible to calculate the asymptotic value. And then here I show the results. So in this test, I was calculating the one-body density matrix for bosons, where I just truncated my Jastrow term very wildly. And also my correlations are now quite bad in the sense that in one-dimensional system, the correlation, the Jastrow correlation should be very strong. And here I just put absolutely no correlation. So my variational result is very bad. So here it describes the decay, and then there is nothing. It's just constant. While the exact result should be something which eventually will decay to zero. Okay, when I do a mixed estimator, okay, it tries to correct, but here it essentially it's not possible. It is not able because, I mean, my function is has completely no physics there. And my extrapolation results are quite bad. So they go in the correct direction, but they are not, well, no, not right. Okay, so then here I decide at which distance I want to get the result, because somehow the calculation is more costly. But in practical, for practical purposes, usually the most interesting point is the one corresponding to largest distance, which would sort of correspond to condensate fraction. And yeah, I think it works pretty well in the sense that it's able to correct and to put the result in the proper place. And also I can do it for fermions, which maybe to some extent is silly in the sense that condensate fraction will be always zero. And then the exact result would be just some oscillations which are slowly decaying to zero. Then if I do it in a variational way, essentially there are no correlations. If I do it in mixed way, then actually it puts some correlation, and in reality here also quite close to the exact result. But then if I do extrapolation, it has no meaning, essentially diverges.
Why is that? The mixed is the same as the exact?
No, it's just coincidence. It's just coincidence.
Yeah, but it's a wonderful coincidence.
Yeah. I think this sometimes might happen, that also the mixed estimator is closer to the exact result than the extrapolated.
No, what it seems there, I mean, I don't know if I can do the topic, but correctly, but the VMC is oscillations are quenched down much faster than the they should. But the period seems to be still decent. I mean,
that's right.
So what are the two extrapolations?
Oh, okay, so
you do the
I can subtract
minus twice the mix minus the variation.
This is one possibility, and the other is I have square of the mixed divided by and in principle they have similar accuracy, so no, there is no preference of one or the other. They're completely different when one of the functions is one of the estimations is zero, because when I divide by zero, this is quite bad. Okay, so I think here are the conclusion that it is possible to do pure estimator for the one-body density matrix, and then okay, this can be used for calculation of the condensate fraction. Yeah, thank you very much for your attention. So for example, I would displace by the largest size I can have, or half size of the box, in order to find finally what would be my condensate fraction.
And basically in your virtual walker, you just diffuse, but you don't branch.
I don't branch. I need to keep what would be its weight. Yeah, this is yes. But okay, I don't branch it. And also it doesn't contribute to the energy, and then I just kill it. Okay, maybe I can as well. But I sort of thought that still the time to which I need to go is not too large, so the weight still can be comparable to one, so just keeping the weight itself, not branching, is okay.
In fact, if you just get weights here, not branching, how long does the weights run, let's say, before? Sooner or later, it's going to be zero, probably.
No, it's not going to be zero.
Yeah, so for example, in this system, which is, sort of fermionic, my Fermi energy will be pi squared. So I think probably I should divide it by pi squared. Yeah, I think it's, I mean, the typical time which I need to go would be, like Fermi energy, well, in inverse Fermi energy. Yeah, which sort of makes sense. This is.
Because this tells you how many of these things you have to put into a reasonable statistics, essentially. Because in your simulations, I mean, you can follow one of these things for a while, and you have to add more, I guess.
Yeah, of course.
So, how do you control, for instance, I mean, how many of these virtual workers you put in? The ratio of the virtual workers versus the ratio of the real workers?
I take quite small one. I don't know. I mean, 10% like of virtual workers.
That's enough to have.
Yes.
Right. So what about two-body density matrix?
I think it's the same.
Yeah, you need to generate two virtuals at different displacements.
No. It's the same. No, it's the same. It's the only thing is that here I moved one particle,
okay.
And now I'll move two particles, but this is still one worker, so it's exactly the same.
But the problem is this is going to probably die out even faster because the weights of a thing like that are probably.
I don't know.
Well, here you have to displace one particle, and
yeah.
Essentially the weight is always.
Condensate, you're okay, right?
Yeah, I mean, but
and you have a condensate, which is usually what you care about.
Yes, in the two body, you still have some. No,
well, I mean, if you have 10% condensate, then that says 10% of the wave function is still the ground state, and the rest is stuff you have to kill.
Okay, yes.
Yeah.
Right.
If you just do naive forward walking without a virtual walker. You'll have a normalization problem, I guess. You have an unknown because in the denominator you have the wrong number of particles. Is that right? I mean, that's essentially what this is correcting. Because that's the kind of it was a long time ago, but when I did forward walking on this.
Because my understanding was that this is, well, sort of standard for local estimators when you just do not displace it. You calculate in the same point, and then you just go back, I mean. But here the problem was that I really need to generate some new worker which was not there before. Because I need to know the weight in a displaced position. Do you follow that?
Yes. I mean, that is what the electronic structure people call sidewalks.
Yeah. This would be, like sidewalk. In the sense that by just standard forward walking, I think what one gets is this ratio. Would be the ratio of the ground state wave function and trial wave function at certain moment of time and certain position. Instead, the quantity which I need is displaced one, where one of the particles is moved. And this is, there is no such a walker just in the standard calculation. I need to create it somehow.
Yeah, if you rewrite the density matrix, formally you're not really integrating over R, right? So so I think it comes out to be the same. I mean, if you ask, and we can talk about it later.
Yeah, okay. Maybe.
Yeah, I mean, it's still, you need to do this or something, I think in the end it comes out to be a kind of a normalization problem. You don't know what the normalization is.
Because also here I have proper normalization in the sense that here I have product of the trial and zero, which is, well, just my standard weight at the position R. So when I generated my worker, it was already correct. And then my new weight, which I obtain, is exactly this one. So I think my normalization here is correct.
I think for you it's okay. I'm saying if you don't do the sidewalk, it's wrong.
Yeah, maybe.
Or you mean if you just have a particle, like here?
Yeah, because then, okay. Yeah, I think it's easier just to write.
are these things where you do the path integral with the split lock, and then you do it with the knot, and this is pre-worm. Then you would get this normalization, but then there was a regime where you had done both calculations.
Actually, in peaks you can do the actual worm and open and close.
Yes.
But actually, I'm even, maybe we should talk about it, because even in pigs with worm sampling, I think for an inhomogeneous system there's a problem with the normalization.
Okay, possibly. I don't know.
More questions?